You bitch! Arrgh!
A sharp obscenity was screamed in the air as Chase went on the attack. Liberty was grabbed and forcefully slammed into the fleshy wall, causing a splash of goo with a sickening, squelching sound. Rocky stared in horror at the domestic exchange, his movements frozen as fear spread across his face.
Chase, calm down!
Zuma snapped through his collar. If the lab was physically there, he probably had a chance at stopping the attack. But here he was, merely words on deaf ears. The Shepherd was spiraling out of control. Already was he haunted by the terrible act he committed just several hours ago, but now dropped into a dark hell of organic corruption, free to defile what remaining hope he had. Learning that Ryder could have played a role in all the chaos was the straw that broke the camel's back. Even then, Chase refused to accept it, instead shifting his attention to something else. Choked out the dachshund as she hit the wall.
What are you?
Chase snarled at her, keeping his strong paws firmly pinned into her body.
What have you done? Tell me now!
He bared his teeth and emitted a fierce snarl, almost ready to tear Liberty to pieces. He hated it. He hated her. He hated the infection. He hated the monster. He hated everything he was being forced to hate, and it sparked a deadly rage within him. And yet, he hated nothing more than himself, and somehow that made him the angriest of all.
I didn't do anything!
Liberty pleaded, trying to wrench free.
I've already told you why I was here! Bullshit!
The Shepherd refused to listen.
Everything you say is bullshit!
Rocky raced over in a desperate attempt to defuse the situation.
Chase!
He put his paws on his friend's shoulder in an attempt to get through to him. Groaning in pain as she was pinned against the living surface, Liberty searched for any meaning left in the Shepherd's eyes.
What happened to you? Do I really have to answer that? Is it not obvious? No, answer me!
Liberty returned a hostile stare.
Everyone is on edge, sure, but you have changed!
She was well accustomed to reading others, picking up on behaviors and mannerisms no one else could.
You aren't the police dog I met in Adventure City!
Liberty, stop! Rocky pleaded for her to cease talking, knowing it would anger Chase even more. She defied the words, going all in as she met Chase's gaze with a smug look.
You know, they say in moments of danger, do you find out what kind of people your friends are?
She grinned, now unfazed as her body remained locked against the surface.
How can you even say that?
Chase said, appalled.
We all witnessed that thing rip out of rubble and lay waste to the courtyard. Of course we've changed.
But there's something else, isn't it?
Liberty laughed.
Marshall and Rocky seem just like I remember them.
Now it was Rocky's turn to be offended.
What?
The dachshund brushed off the comment.
Why you, Chase? Why are you different? What happened to you?
She leaned in, staring directly into Chase's seething pupils. To do this was risking her life, as one wrong comment could send the Shepherd into a frenzy and kill her. To think that Chase was capable of killing someone was a haunting thought, but something told Liberty that it wasn't far off from the truth.
I told the truth, didn't I? Now you tell me yours.
Berserk screams played a storm in Chase's head. The static that clouded his mind still remained, only now it was beginning to take form. It twisted and turned its noise into words, issuing commands that Chase hadn't yet obeyed. They were getting louder, however, and the noise was slowly pulling the puppy into suffering and distress. It looked like he was thinking. The Shepherd's eyes flicked around like he was searching for answers to the situation, but he wasn't. He was fighting, frantically pushing back his own mind in a desperate attempt to not be responsible for another death. He couldn't kill her, at least not now.
My
truth? He breathed out, now finally registering what Liberty had asked him. His ears fell, then stood again, like his own body was unsure how to react.
Yes, and...
Liberty let a chuckle slide.
Can you please let me down?
After a moment, Chase obliged and released his city friend from his grasp, but not without narrowing his eyes in a distrustful gesture. Rocky could be heard sighing in relief, thanking whatever deity above that the situation had not escalated more than it had. It was then a wave of confusion and shame hit the mixed breed, a feeling that was new and unprepared for. Watching Chase manhandle Liberty was disturbing, and now he wondered if there was something more he could have done about it. It was obvious that just his word alone wouldn't save the Dachshund. Would he have been able to restrain Chase and save her? He felt useless, evident as he slightly turned away from the duo and stared off into a line of teeth that trailed along the sickly pink wall. Chase sat down, not caring that his tail was now dipped in translucent sludge. Was it finally time to tell the truth? It wasn't. It couldn't be. He had to let someone know, but he couldn't let anyone know. It was tearing him apart inside to see over and over the atrocity he had committed. Yet every second it remained untold was another second he was free. Was he truly free? Was it freeing to never tell the truth? The static only became stronger the more he sealed the truth within him. But he knew the static was never going away. Or was it?
Chase?
Liberty tilted her head, reaching out to the broken shepherd. When he pulled the trigger on Sky, his spirit immediately shattered apart. The pieces were dropped down into the void, left to burn in endless suffering over the one stupid action he wished he could take back. The static told him that nothing remained, that he was merely a cold, lifeless shell of what he once was. But darkness was known to lie. Perhaps there was one faint glimmer of himself still fighting to be relevant. A tiny remnant of a loyal shepherd in blue that would jump to action to help those he loved. He slowly turned his head to his friend, too ashamed to actually meet the mix's gaze.
Rocky, go on ahead.
Huh?
Just, please, give us a minute.
The mix looked to Liberty, who returned a small nod to him. Unsure of himself, he sighed and turned away. He didn't want to be alone, and wandering off into a dark living abyss was not something he was fond of doing. He started walking, leaving Chase and Liberty behind as he took to the corridor. He wouldn't go far, just enough until they were out of earshot, then he'd stay put and hide. Chase watched him go, seeing the gray, white-tipped tail disappear into the darkness. He already regretted everything he was agreeing to, but there was no other option. To tell Marshall the truth would break their bond, destroying the brotherly relationship they've built over the years. Telling Rocky would shatter his trust, leaving him to denounce Chase's leadership he so fiercely upheld. Telling Zuma would be his worst mistake. It would confirm everything the lab already suspected, and possibly result in a bloody dogfight.
He's gone, Liberty said simply, sitting down to face Chase. Now talk to me.
His mind grew, forcing Chase to wince slightly as a piercing noise hit his ear. Liberty remained unaffected, witnessing front row the mental agony he was going through. It all built up into one cacophony of crooked music, screeching so loud he could barely hear anything else. He had to tell her, but another voice scolded him not to. He wanted to open up, but a force within him constantly stabbed in a needle and threaded through his body, sewing up his lie to never see the light. Tell her. Don't tell her. Tell her. Don't tell her. He shook his head a little, his voice cracking. The static spiraled out of control, threatening to consume his brain. Pressure was building like an active volcano. It churned and intensified, all leading up to one powerful mind break to take Chase's soul into the void where it belonged.
I...
he said again, needing his pause. His ears deafened, vision blurring over as words and phrases echoed in his head. He couldn't quite make out what they were saying, but they were all fizzling like a ticking bomb, screaming and wailing. Farrakh's malice screech played on repeat in his ears, forcing him to listen over and over until he was so disoriented he couldn't breathe.
I killed Sky.
Everything stopped. It all suddenly stopped like a flick of a light switch. Chase felt a weight lift from him, riding alongside the pained, broken words that left his muzzle. His mind was quiet again, and he could breathe easily for the first time in hours.
What?
Liberty drew back a little, raising her eyebrow.
I killed her.
Well, she was infected, wasn't she?
Liberty shrugged.
You did what you had to do.
No, you don't understand!
The shepherd whined, trying to fight back tears.
She was never infected to begin with.
The dachshund's eyes widened in shock, now beginning to catch on.
Hell, at the time I didn't know if Farrakh's malice was even here.
Chase hung his head.
But Cyrus made it sound so horrible, and I was scared,
he confessed.
I was so scared, like when I had to go back to Adventure City. But it was so much worse this time.
A sorrowful feeling hit him as he remembered the traumatizing events he endured beneath the skyscrapers of the city. His memory called back to the device Cyrus had given him.
He gave me this thing. A thing that could apparently read blood and sound an alarm when it detected anything foreign. I knew Sky was sick, as did everyone else, and, well, that was what I mostly hinged on.
What was she sick with?
Liberty asked.
Fuck if I know! Could have been literally just the flu or something!
The shepherd growled slightly.
But it was a terrible coincidence that I focused on, completely ignoring everyone else. Who knows? Rubble could have had an obvious sign of being infected, and I never caught it!
His friend moved to his side, slowly and sympathetically placing her paw onto his.
I murdered her, Liberty!
He choked out, voice breaking.
I just fucking shot her like a common criminal! She didn't even have time to react! She just died!
He tried to say something else, but the shepherd could no longer contain himself. He lowered his head, a simple pose on the outside, but within he was torn to shreds, his mistakes and failures scratching at his heart. He had failed his patrol, he failed Ryder, he failed Adventure Bay, and he failed himself.
Chase, I...
his friend said softly, stopping as she tried to find the words.
I'm so sorry.
She gently leaned on his shoulder and draped an arm around him, pulling him in for a soft hug. Chase didn't return the gesture.
To make matters worse, he said again, I left my gun in the boiler room, along with the ACG radio Cyrus gave me. Like an idiot, I discarded them. Now the power's out, and I can't get them back without Rocky fixing the breakers. And for that, he needs to come down here. We're literally in this mess because of me. It's all my fault.
Dogs make mistakes. It's okay.
Liberty tried to reason within him.
No!
Chase replied a little harshly.
To call this a mistake is insufficient. I fucked up. I completely fucked up.
Okay, well...
she stammered, growing a tad agitated.
Everyone fucks up at some point. Look at me!
You?
He met her gaze.
What have you ever done?
A lot of things.
She laughed awkwardly.
I...
She took a deep breath.
I had to give up a puppy once.
The words left her mouth, and for a moment, Chase didn't believe what he even heard.
Puppy?
He tilted his head.
What do you mean?
An infant, Chase, she clarified.
I had an infant. An infant I couldn't take care of.
A sad sigh left her as she too bowed her head.
So I had to give him up. Left him at the fire station.
Aren't you a puppy, though? The police officer put together.
How did you... Let's just say I made a really big mistake.
Liberty held a paw out, gesturing as she spoke.
And as a result, I may have changed or completely ended the life of an infant. Jesus. So I guess what I'm trying to say is, I understand. A little, at least.
She gave a soft smile.
Even though it was roughly a year ago, it still haunts me. I guess I didn't kill anyone that I know of.
The two dogs sat in silence, both listening to the gentle churning of the stomach-like hallway they resided in. It was a weirdly calming sound to Chase's ears, a feeling he never thought he'd cross with the disgusting nightmare that Farrakh's malice had created down there.
What am I supposed to tell Ryder?
He said finally, staring down at the floor.
That I killed one of our own? By mistake?
I don't think Ryder is coming back.
The shepherd whipped around in a snarl.
He is! You'll see!
A faint whine emitted from him as he backed up to look around at the hellish environment.
Ryder wouldn't abandon us. He never would.
Grunting as he called forward all the strength within him, Zuma heaved in a strained breath, pushing aside a folded table that was blocking a new door. The lab was eager to get moving, motivated by the discovery of a device that seemingly interfered with their communications. He put his nose on the floor and searched for any possible sign of a new path, eventually discovering a door that was blocked by a variety of discarded utilities. Marshall sat aside, dragging his paws along the ground, a subtle coping mechanism as he tried to keep himself calm. Zuma seemed oblivious to his friend's distress, or he did know it, but was just ignoring it. The Dalmatian watched his friend attempt to dislodge a large computer, the last object in the way of the door. Unfortunately, it was significantly heavier than anything else, and Zuma was unsuccessful. The spotted puppy tried to reach out to the lab.
I want to go back to Chase.
Why? Zuma said in a simple reply, not even turning around.
What's so special about him?
Nothing, I just...
The Dalmatian lowered himself to the floor, resting his chin on his paws.
No offense, Zuma, but I think I just feel safer with him.
Now Zuma whipped around.
Safer than me? Chase will throw you to that thing the first chance he gets!
I've noticed you really don't trust him that much anymore.
Marshall narrowed his eyes.
Well, you can't trust most these days.
The lab's words were disturbing to his companion, more so considering the irony of that statement. Getting increasingly anxious, Marshall licked his paw a few times before getting to his fur. There was little he could do to actually soothe his fears, with the simple groom being the next best thing. Zuma tried to move the obstacle again, but to no avail.
Damn it! Literally the one thing in our way! Maybe there's another way to move it.
Marshall tried to get his participation in, not wanting Zuma to think he was lazy.
There isn't, unless you have super strength. I guess we could really use those Mighty Pup powers right about now,
the Dalmatian said with a faint smile, remembering the adventures they had. His smile then fell, remembering the only pup to gain super strength was Rubble. It was obvious that Zuma was remembering too, as there was a noticeable dip in his mood, a wave of sadness raining on him.
Rubble's gone,
he said softly, quietly mourning the loss of his good friend. Picking his head up a little, Marshall got up and walked over to his friend, seeking to comfort him. Coming to his side, the spotted dog held out his arm, offering a hug. Zuma completely ignored it, not even looking at his companion.
"This is Chase's fault,"
he hissed.
"What has he done?"
It was a solid question. What exactly had Chase done? He went behind the backs of the team, conspiring with the military organization that scarred Rocky. He withheld vital information from them, keeping away a twisted secret that a threat walked alongside the dogs, and didn't reveal it until the very last minute while flashing a gun around. That was the worst one. The gun. The weapon that Chase, as a police officer, would surely be so familiar with. He murdered Sky in front of everyone, and Zuma now fully believed that to be a fact. He didn't need Chase to confess his sins or secretly slide him a note with the truth written on it. He simply just knew that Chase was no longer the German Shepherd they once loved and laughed with. That dog was insane, no less a monster than the creature that hunted them.
"He killed Sky, Marshall."
The words hit the Dalmatian like a bullet train, and he could be seen visibly freezing up.
He stammered. "I know. Can we not talk about this?"
"No, you're not understanding!"
Zuma turned to face him.
"Sky never had the monster in her. It was rubble. Chase assumed it was her and shot her in front of everyone without even giving her a fair chance to explain."
"No, that's not..."
Marshall blinked, a confused expression on his face as he tried to process the information.
"He wouldn't..."
"Wouldn't what?"
the lab challenged him.
"Kill someone? He's a cop! It's what they do!"
The Dalmatian backed up, staring in horror as he defied the words.
"Zuma, no! He..."
His voice went shaky.
"You can hate Chase, but you can't say these things about him!"
"Say what? The truth?"
Zuma followed steadily, beginning to back Marshall into a wall.
"Maybe if you weren't so starry-eyed around him, you'd actually see it!"
A low growl escaped from him, and Marshall drew back further, now feeling even more afraid.
"I don't trust him, and you shouldn't either," Zuma shrugged. "And I'm not forcing that on you. It's just my... suggestion. We could all die down here if we make the wrong move, given the circumstances. We can't afford to keep holding our trust on someone if we feel they'll tear us all down."
"You mean..."
Marshall dared to say, a fit of defiance rising in him.
"Someone like you?"
Bewildered at the Dalmatian's accusation, Zuma was tempted to lash at him, but such a gesture would only solidify him as a broken bond. He couldn't afford to lose the trust of his companions.
"No, not me. You can trust me,"
he nodded.
"You need to."
"Well, here's a newsflash,"
came the firefighter's response, puffing up his white fur and baring his teeth.
"I don't trust you!"
A loud bang suddenly tore through the air, making both dogs draw back in surprise. The sound resembled a punch of metal, like something threw itself into a solid wall. It was then that Zuma realized in horror just how loud they were talking. The conversation had escalated far beyond safe perimeters. Marshall paled, unable to move as he darted his vision around in paranoia.
"What was that?"
Turning to look back at the fleshy orifice they had climbed through to get into the room, Zuma scanned over it as if he was searching for something. It seemed like the only way inside until the lab looked up and noticed several displaced ceiling tiles. It would be all too easy for something to drop in from above.
"Hide!"
Zuma tried to hide his own fear in his voice. Marshall didn't hear, still paralyzed.
"Hide!"
he snapped, and finally, the Dalmatian rendered his words. The spotted dog turned back to the tables and cabinets.
"Hide where?"
Crawling under a table was easy, but it was also just as easy to glance under one to check for prey. The cabinets were tight and claustrophobic, not a phobia Marshall had, but still an uncomfortable position to be in.
Are you sure it?
An echo suddenly sounded through the room, resembling that of a long, layered exhale of breath. It was like a hiss, like the building itself was breathing around them. Soon after, the sound of metal clawing and scraping began to tear into their ears, vastly approaching. Marshall didn't need to ask twice, exploding into a panicked run and making haste toward the storage cabinets. He clicked open the first door and tried to climb in, only stopping upon realizing it was full of papers and assorted office equipment. Zuma broke into action, searching for a place to hide. Hiding with Marshall seemed like the easy option, but also the most dangerous as it would render both dogs dead should they be found. Even though the separation was a terrible idea in situations like this, now was a unique time when it was necessary. The lab ran at another cabinet a few feet away when suddenly another banging sound hit his ears. And it was close.
Where in the world was Farrakh's malice? With how close it sounded, it seemed like it'd be in the room by now.
Panicking, he abandoned his course of action and dove under one of the tables, staying low to the ground to avoid sticking out too much. Marshall was completely concealed, but Zuma had found a less favorable place. If he was found, he'd have little time to react. The only saving grace was that the table had a massive blanket of fabric draped over it, a sheet probably used to cover up old computers. He knew the creature was rather tall, so it wouldn't see him right away, and the dusty blanket was helping in obscuring him. Marshall chose another door, his paws stumbling with the latch as fear and dread were overriding his focus. Clicking the door open, he saw the cabinet was completely empty. Not wasting even a second of time, he climbed into it and shut the door behind him. Now contained like old food in Tupperware, Marshall had only the three horizontal slits on the door to peek out with. He held his breath, tried to slow his pounding heart, and patiently waited for any sign of the monster. Several minutes passed, and neither dog heard or saw anything. Zuma sat motionless like the dead, double-checking every second that his tail had not idly slid out into view. He feared for Marshall, believing right away the puppy was at risk of messing something up and giving himself away. He was surrounded by the unknown and refused to come out unless he was absolutely sure. Locked away in the cabinet, Marshall had the advantage of actually being able to see out. He scanned his eyes around the room, a difficult motion due to his limited field of view.
Where is it?
They heard it so clearly, so close, like it was directly above their heads just waiting to pounce. The creature probably would have just ambushed the room entirely if the dogs continued arguing. Marshall waited another few seconds, but still there was no sign of it. He gently placed a paw on the door, once again taking a peek through the slits before he pushed out. A mangled paw of flesh suddenly slapped onto the front of the door, coming down from above like a rotten chunk of meat and bone. Marshall suppressed a scream and drew back as far as he possibly could. Its claws slowly scratched at its metal surface, and Farrakh's malice climbed down from on top of the cabinets. The Dalmatian was unable to control his heavy breathing.
Where in the world did it come from if he didn't see it come down from the ceiling?
Dragging itself down, the creature's body of gore passed over the cabinet. And for once, Marshall managed to get a clear view of its underbelly. To say Farrakh's malice had an underbelly was a stretch. A belly was a soft, ticklish surface usually covered in fur, eager for belly rubs to appease all the stress and anxiety of a dog. What Marshall was seeing now was nothing like the sort, a sight that made him gag in horror. The literal belly of the beast was a crude canvas of gore, sprouting webs of tendons to secure its squirming body mass. Despite its incredibly thin bone frame, Its chest did have a visible ribcage that jutted out of its upper spine, resembling more of a cold, empty cage where a heart should be. The stomach was visible off to the right, audibly gurgling away as it worked to digest some horrific foreign material. The stomach was hastily fastened to the spine with the intestine and was the only organ Marshall could visibly recognize. He had no feasible idea what any of the other mess under the creature was, but it did catch his eye that Farrakh's Malice had no visible heart. With what small, limited view he had of its ribcage, he swore he saw the faint outline of a small dog, maybe two, maybe four, trapped within the organic mass behind the ribs. An unspeakable horror was dangling from the monster's groin. Between its legs, a fleshy, gurgling sack hung like loose, dead flesh. It looked swollen, gradually stretching from the clusters of unborn eggs swimming inside it. A small, contracted opening was visible at the sack's end, a tiny nub following the direction of its tail. It was sealed tightly so that not a drop of precious cytoplasm would leak out of the body, yet patiently waiting for another egg ready to push out. To even lay his eyes on such an organ made Marshall feel sick, the sight alone making his stomach twist. Farrakh's Malice was very, very pregnant. Scraping off of the cabinets, the predator slithered into the room, its thin tail flicking like an antenna. Its footsteps were heavy and loud, terrifying Zuma the closer he heard them draw near. The creature was far from unintelligent, fully aware that its prey was nearby. It knew not to waste its energy overturning tables and ripping down walls. Another method would work just as fine, if not better. Lowering its ripped, skin-masked head, it opened its mouth and moved around its vocal cords. A gentle, soft voice left its maw.
Guys?
Zuma stopped cold, his eyes widening in a mix of shock and bewilderment. Marshall heard it just as clearly, and the Dalmatian came forward a little in the cabinet, itching to get a look. That was Rubble's voice.
Guys, I'm here!
The bulldog's voice echoed.
Zuma, where are you?
Farrakh's Malice wasn't moving its mouth, nor had fully intact lips to form words. It didn't need them. Its mutation had been left unchecked for so long, allowing it to reach a new stage in its evolution. Rubble wasn't finished yet. It needed more body mass to put the bulldog back together enough to make it convincing. Even then, if one had a few seconds before standing before the creature, they'd be able to see Rubble's head poking out of its left shoulder. He wouldn't be the only one. Farrakh's Malice maliciously prepared room in its body for five more dogs.
Marshall,
Zuma breathed, despite knowing his friend couldn't hear him.
Please don't.
The firefighter was almost hypnotized by the voice of his fallen friend, making him paw at the door of the cabinet. He missed Rubble so much, and Sky just as well. They hadn't physically seen Rubble get torn apart. To Marshall, that was reason enough that he could still be alive. He stuttered, gently scratching at the door with his spotted paw.
Rubble?
He wanted so desperately to come out, yet he knew he'd die if he would. But he had to. He couldn't, but he could. But Farrakh's Malice was out there. But what if it wasn't out there? What if it really was Rubble? An odd, lingering noise of static had entered the Dalmatian's head, sending his mind into a whirlwind of questions and reasonings. Marshall shook his head, trying to pull himself back to reality. Returning his gaze to the door, he looked out to try and see his old friend. But his view had changed. He could see the musky, bloodied fangs of Farrakh's Malice maw breathing into the cabinet. A horrific war cry screeched into the air as Farrakh's Malice snarled at its prey. Marshall squeezed himself back into the cabinet as far as he would go, now audibly shrieking in terror like a terrified puppy. Flexing its claws, the creature hissed at its contained food and raked its paw as hard as possible across the metal surface, producing a sound like the scraping of a chalkboard in half a second. Zuma jumped out from under the table, filled with horror as he stared at his doomed friend.
Marshall!
The door held, its metal built resisting the blooded razors of Farrakh's malice claws. Irritated at the failed attack, the monster bristled the tentacles from its back in agitation. It balled its degloved paw, pulling the arm back as it wound up its strength. In a blinding second, it punched into the cabinet door, instantly deforming it and bending it inwards. Some of its hinges snapped and flew off like broken wood chips, gently bouncing to the floor like dropped coins. The sound of the impact was like a gunshot, echoing through the air, making Zuma flinch. The lab was completely exposed, yet Farrakh's malice ignored his presence, deliberately targeting the Dalmatian. The screams the puppy made, the frantic scribbles of its spotted paws in the confined cabinet, it filled the monster with adrenaline. The creature let its claws drift through the exposed openings around the door, seductively trailing its nails along the edges. Marshall had lost the memo to remain calm and silent, his life flashing before his eyes as he cowered before the monster tearing into his hiding spot. The Dalmatian cried out helplessly as he was completely trapped with nowhere to run other than the jaws of death. In a brilliant display of power, the creature jerked its arm back and snapped the door from its place, tossing it away like garbage. The firefighter tried to back up, only for a tentacle to coil around his neck in an instant. With brutal cruelty, Marshall was forcefully ripped out of his safety. A feeble grunt escaped his muzzle as his body collided with the hard tile floor. Dazed, the puppy whimpered and meekly looked up, only to see Farrakh's malice sucking back in the tentacle through its arm.
No!
The Dalmatian gasped, trying to crawl away. Leaning its head down, Farrakh's malice scanned its prey, seemingly anticipating their next move.
Come on, Marshall.
Rubble's voice echoed from the mass of gore.
Why would you fight something so beautiful?
The predator slid a tentacle over its lips like a squirming appendage, then roared down at the puppy, baring its jaws of teeth. Acting fast, Zuma jumped up on one of the computer tables, frantically looking for anything to save his friend. There was a fire extinguisher sitting idly a few feet away. Just another in the numerous that seemed to be sprinkled around the basement. Panicked, Zuma jumped from table to table, accidentally slipping as he landed awkwardly on the third. He grunted from the impact, gripping his dull claws into the table's surface. Farrakh's malice picked its head up, eyeing the Labrador with a warning hiss. Seeing the monster distracted, Marshall attempted to roll back on his paws and run away. He didn't even get 2 inches away before Farrakh's malice stepped its leg onto his back, painfully pinning him to the floor.
Why wasn't it just killing them right away? Why not just end their suffering now? Yeah!
Zuma grabbed the fire extinguisher in his arms with all the strength he had.
Eat this!
Calling forward a burst of energy, he flung the pressured explosive directly at the monster. The red projectile smacked Farrakh's malice in the face, bouncing off its cheek and making the creature hiss in annoyance. It plummeted to the floor with a loud crash, eventually rolling to a stop. The impact caused a dent in its shell, and a hissing sound could be heard. Snarling in anger, the predator released Marshall, only to open its palm and shoot out a writhing tentacle. The appendage coiled around the dog's torso and yanked him helplessly into the air. The spotted puppy flailed as he was picked up.
Help!
Pulling the tentacle back in, Farrakh's malice caught Marshall in its paw, roared furiously into the air, and flung the puppy into Zuma. Zuma had to dive off the table to avoid the friendly fire, landing lightly on his neck. The landing didn't kill him, but came dangerously close, instead sending a shock through the lab's body. Marshall flew past him, crashing into the back wall and ricocheting off. A bloodstain was left where Marshall hit the surface, and the puppy landed limply on the floor. A faint twitch emitted from his paw before the Dalmatian entirely stopped moving, blood leaking around him. The fire extinguisher continued hissing, the compounded chemicals within it struck from the force. With haste, they struggled to stabilize, but the damage to their protective shell was more than it could handle. The leaking gas began to emit a smell. Zuma turned his head where his partner had fallen, his breathing erratic and shaky.
Marshall!
He scrambled backward in the office, shaking his head in denial.
No!
He tried to scream something else, but the monster's roar drowned it out. Gripping its claws into the floor, Farrakh's malice stalked to Zuma, gritting its teeth. There was no way out this time, a revelation that tauntingly jeered at the Labrador as he frantically looked for any direction to flee. Death stared him in the eyes. His heart skipped beats as he pressed up against the wall in terror. The Coast Guard of the Paw Patrol left at the mercy of the perfect killer. Fed up with the games, Farrakh's malice brandished its claws and roared in fury, lunging for the puppy. Like a primed landmine, the fire extinguisher detonated spectacularly. Pressured gas blasted out of the fractured container, immediately erupting into burning flames. The explosion, condensed into one small room, smashed through the tables and hurled loose objects into the walls. Farrakh's malice was thrown off balance, stumbling at its feet while it tried to shake the disoriented feeling from its head. Seizing its escape, the creature scampered away, only to stop directly in front of a pile of burning papers. Veering its body to avoid it, Farrakh's malice lost balance and crashed into a set of storage cabinets. The entire display crumbled on top of it, burying the monster in splintered wood, twisted metal, and various clumsy objects. The fleshy, tight cavern that led to the hive behind them suddenly pulsed with life. Reacting to the detected threat, its walls closed in, sealing itself tightly to protect the rest of the nest. The sudden action knocked Zuma out briefly, the puppy's blurred vision slowly returning to that of a burning room. Smoke and splintered wood showered him from all directions.
Marshall!
He called, trying to shield his eyes from the stinging smoke. With no other option, Zuma ran to Marshall, blindly traversing the chaos. A piercing static in his head was shrieking over and over, following him as he grabbed Marshall's body by the scruff. With what little strength he could muster, Zuma dragged Marshall as best as he could through the room, his fur slowly burning over from the searing heat alone. The old computer, even now charred and damaged beyond repair from the blast, still sat in front of it, pinning the door closed. The whole room was in molten shambles, with nothing but heat and splinters every 2 feet. The fire was slowly dying, as the blast had occurred in a somewhat isolated corner of the room, and it was running out of things to spread to. 4 massive tentacles exploded out of the debris that coated the floor, an enraged screech tearing from the soot and ash. They writhed and twisted, coiling around the fallen tables and furniture that pinned down their host. Contracting with all their might, the powerful appendages crushed them inward, forcing through the old wood until the objects were snapped entirely in half. It was going to dig itself out. Zuma was completely trapped with not a single safe place to go. The gory tunnel behind him had sealed itself, the confounded door in front of him still barred access, and Farrakh's malice was already creating dust clouds as it tore itself free. Holding Marshall in his arms, Zuma struggled to ease his fears, his life flashing before his eyes while he backed up against the wall.
"Not like this,"
he pleaded.
"Not like this."
The monster's roar filled the room, making the lab hold his dear friend even tighter, fearfully awaiting his demise. Did you hear that? Chase narrowed his eyes, pricking his ears. Liberty and Rocky stopped walking, tuning their senses to any noise around them. Their surroundings were quiet for a few seconds, until the sound of a smashed table echoed to them.
What is that?
Rocky took a small step forward, flattening his ears.
Is that the creature?
Chase and Liberty met up with Rocky soon after their conversation, rejoining the concerned mix and continuing their hike through the basement. As they each walked, the dogs carried their individual thoughts over the matter. Chase was filled with an odd combination of fear and determination, striving to fix his mistakes while still boiling in shame. Rocky's thoughts were on his shepherd friend, quietly worried about his mental stability. Plotting in secret, Liberty scanned dozens of ways in her head to find the samples she needed. She wasn't going back to the Arcline Foundation empty pod. She needed at least something. Pointing a gray paw, Rocky eyed a jointing path up ahead, briefly obscured by bloodied intestine hanging from the ceiling.
It sounded like an explosion. From there!
He pointed his paw down a new jointing tunnel.
Let's go!
Wait, we're going to the threat?
Chase whipped his head at him, staring at the mix.
Are you insane? You want to go toward the thing that's been killing all of us?
Ignoring him, Rocky sped up toward the new path.
We left Zuma and Marshall. They could be in trouble.
Bad idea, Rocky. Why can't we just keep going straight? He flicked his ears toward the continuing path.
There's no sense in making twists and turns.
I'm not leaving my friends, Chase.
Well,
Chase stuttered, trying to formulate a response that didn't make him sound horrible.
I think maybe we...
He hesitated again, completely lost in his words. Liberty pushed past him.
Here, I'll go forward. You go with Rocky.
She instantly charged off, leaving no opportunity for Chase to respond.
Oh, fantastic! I get to go see the death monster with my idiot friend.
The shepherd grumbled, walking to follow Rocky. Picking up his pace, he caught up with the mix as he was pushing under the hanging tendrils. There was a fierce spark of tenacity within the mixed breed, and Chase felt a pang of jealousy. It wasn't fair that Rocky was stronger-willed than him.
Oh good, you're with me on this!
Rocky flashed an endearing smile at his partner.
No, I am fucking not!
They approached a metal door that was sealed shut. It wasn't made out of wood or had visible hinges or knobs. It was an electric door that lifted up and down, made of a sturdy material that wasn't easily broken.
Whatever's behind here must be important.
Rocky narrowed his eyes.
How do we open this?
Chase approached the door and sniffed around its outline, pawing at the fleshy sludge. Trailing his arm along, he located a lever that was buried under the gore.
Here, he said with mild amusement, gripping the handle in his teeth and yanking it down.
The door opened by itself, almost like magic, providing access to a dark room. Rocky walked inside before Chase had finished wiping his mouth of the blood. Looking around, the mix noticed what looked like an odd box with buttons on the side of it.
The hell?
He turned his head to see a large maze of pipes running along the left wall, likely a master plumbing system. Chase followed in after him.
What is this, some kind of utility room?
Walking deeper in, Rocky rounded a corner.
No, I think it's some kind of...
He stopped in his tracks, coming up a new doorway.
Sheesh, why is it so hot over here?
He panted slightly, feeling an immense climb in temperature radiating from the new door. He almost turned away when an idea pinged his head.
Wait, is this the boiler room?
Is it?
Rocky walked up behind him.
Certainly feels like one.
I need this door open!
The shepherd jumped to action, motivated at the thought of his problems ending. He nearly threw himself at the lever on the wall, assuming the mechanism was the same as the last one. Rocky watched him with a stunned expression as Chase pulled the lever door, and a click of gears was heard. The door opened, instantly releasing a massive blast of searing heat, as if it had been waiting for them on the other side. The flames took Rocky by surprise, forcing him to jump back with an exclaiming cry. The heat caught Chase in his side, throwing him to the floor and roasting over him. They both shielded themselves for dear life as the pressurized room vented out. With a jamming clang, the door only opened a third of the way before getting stuck. Just 4 feet in the room, Zuma looked over in surprise. The computer table sharply knocked to the side as the door opened, falling over into the flames.
What?
The lab blinked through the smoke, realizing he was completely wrong about why the door wasn't opening.
Chase?
The shepherd scrambled to his paws, retreating from the flames.
What the hell happened in here?
A monstrous canine arm wedged free from the debris, Ferox Malice loudly tearing itself out from under its trap. Each of its limbs speared out, its head pushing up from the crumbled metal.
Run!
Zuma shouted with what little voice he had left, hurriedly taking Marshall through the doorway.
Go! Go! We'll trap it in here!
Rocky screamed as he spotted the lever Chase had used. They had already spotted Marshall's broken state, a sight that shot Chase the moment he saw it.
No, he couldn't be.
The shepherd panicked.
Had Zuma done something?
Zuma had to have done something. Rage flared in his veins as he watched the lab pull the puppy through, and Chase turned with a hostile grimace. Approaching the brown dog, he opened his mouth to spit an accusation. Wood and metal blasted outward, spraying across the charred room as Ferox Malice erupted free. Tearing its burdens to pieces, the monster swiftly backhanded any annoying little object still in its vision as it climbed out. Its legs were still pinned, crushing its bones with a fiery agony that only intensified its rage. Unhinging its jaw, a sickening cracking noise emitted while its gums flared to life. A large tentacle, rivaling its tail in size, regurgitated out with a spilling of red and bodily fluid. It moved in the air like a massive snake, hissing jaws of its own. Ferox Malice screeched loudly, flicking its head to whip the weapon forward. Chase turned back at the noise, flattening his ears in terror as he saw it coming.
Rocky, look out!
The mix had little time to react as he heard Chase's words. He flashed the shepherd a single look of surprise, only to feel something wet and tough coil around his leg. Rocky was yanked off balance and hit the floor, screaming in panic as Ferox Malice tightened its hold on him. Desperately reaching for the door lever that was just 3 inches from his paw, he tried with all his puppy might to fight against its hold, but slowly he began to get pulled in.
Chase the door!
He yelled, grabbing anything he could to fight it. A sharp jerk traveled down the tentacle, whipping Rocky's body around in such ways that threatened to dislocate his leg. The shepherd tried to stand, but a disorienting wave blurred over his vision. The proximity to the creature seemed to have an odd effect on him.
Chase!
Rocky planted his claws into the floor, desperately trying to save himself.
Huh?
The police officer blinked, stumbling to his paws.
Huh?
The door!
Ferox Malice roared, its jaw unhinging even more. The base of the large tentacle pushed out of its mouth, revealing itself to the room. It was entirely made up with the body of a very familiar bulldog, his mangled body integrated into the weapon. Rubble violently jerked and convulsed, his split skull opened for the tentacle to shoot out of it. His small, stubby legs, what remained of them, clawed and flailed with every motion Ferox Malice made.
Chase! Get the...
Rocky cried out. Zuma flew by Chase, bumping past him as he jumped to the lever. In a solid motion, the lab gripped the lever and yanked it down, activating the mechanism. The door shut almost instantaneously, locking the creature inside the room and nearly crushing Rocky from above. The massive tentacle holding the mix was severed, prompting an echoed howl of rage on the other side. The horror was over, at least for now. Rocky scrambled backward, breathing heavily as he was filled with terror.
Zuma! I'm here.
The lab went to his side, helping him untangle his legs. It was finally now that Chase's static-filled mind cleared again, and he came back to reality. Blinking in confusion, he looked around and spotted Rocky getting up, nuzzling Zuma in gratitude.
Oh,
he stuttered in quiet surprise, a gut-wrenching feeling of shame hitting him. Before he could say anything, Rocky and Zuma raced off, seeking to check Marshall's condition despite leaving Chase completely alone.
Hey, wait,
he muttered, running after them. On the other end, Farrakh's malice stumbled back, shock hitting its body from its tendrils being cut. It was of little concern in the long run, as it had mutated enough to regenerate at a faster frequency. More was coming soon anyway. It was of little importance. Finally pulling itself free, the creature hissed as it approached the door, scanning for a way through only to be met with none. It swallowed rubble in the cut end of the tentacle, growling at its opposition. It was filled with hatred, and a piece of it wanted to tear into the wall and tunnel back to them. Only then its nose caught a smell, a scent that made it stop in its tracks. Turning its head, it followed the smell of the dachshund, the dog who foolishly split up from the group. Snarling in hunger, the creature shook itself off and raced down the hallway.